March 9th, we're in Larry Bell's studio on 72 Market Street.
77.
77?
Yeah.
72 was Irwin's place.
Oh, shoot. 77 Market Street, Venice, yeah. California.
Yeah.
So Larry, we sat down with you at one point and we talked a little bit about Chouinard and War Babies, but it was with a larger group, and I thought maybe you could tell me a little bit about why you chose to go to Chouinard in the first place.
I went to Chouinard because I thought I was going to get into animation. Chouinard was a, only thing I knew about this art school was that it was a training ground for Disney's animators and designers. And I had drawn cartoons, I liked to draw cartoons in high school. I wasn't much good at anything else, and so I figured maybe I'll go off to art school, learn how to get a job with Disney. And when I got there, part of the curriculum was painting, and that was one of the beginning classes, and all of the design and animation and cartooning classes were things that you took after you'd been there for a couple of years. And I met Bob Irwin's first class teaching was my first semester at Chouinard, teaching at Chouinard, and it was my first semester as a student. And there were other instructors there that, like, there was a guy named Robert Chewy, and after I was there for about a year, Emerson Wolfer came, and Richards Rubin. There was a powerful group of people, and on occasion, if Irwin or somebody couldn't make it, they'd send in a surrogate, like Bankston or Altoon or somebody like that would come in and take the class for the day. So you can imagine the humor level that existed around there, and it was totally addictive and seductive. And I just decided I want to live in a world that has this humor in it all the time. And those guys that teach and work in the animation and Disney department, Mouse House as we called it, didn't have anywhere near this fun sense of life that I sense from these people. And so I switched my interest from becoming a cartoonist or animator to painting. I didn't have the slightest idea what that meant. I mean, I just liked being around those guys, and I liked the smell of the turpentine, and I mean, it was just something real tactile about the whole thing. You had tools, you had little brushes, and you know, learned how to stretch canvas and all kinds of stuff that I had never done before, so it was a very formative and sensitive time for me. I was really wired and excited, and I came out of high school, barely got out of high school. I was a terrible student in school, but I can attribute a lot of stuff from my problems I had prior to art school to my poor hearing, which wasn't diagnosed for 26 more years. I think part of what I sensed about those people came from their humor, which was always in some way related to the silliness of our civilization, and a lot of it was the stuff between the words. It was that made them silly, you know, and in a funny way that seemed to connect with the whole idea of painting, that between the canvas and the paint was some other weird sense of humor that lived as a layer in these people's trip. And I was just enthralled to hang around with them.
We certainly had a good group of fellow students.
Oh,
so
yeah.
Tell us who was in your class.
Ruche, Joe Good, Eddie Burrell, Don Bacardi, Jerry McMillan, Ron Miyashiro, Dean Cushman. I mean, all guys that went on to with their work and are still around today, except for Altoon. He's about the only one of that big group of people that is not with us anymore.
And what kind of professor was Bob Irwin? What kind of teacher?
He was great. He had said he was probably the most charismatic person I ever met.
Would you start by just saying Bob Irwin?
Bob Irwin was probably the most charismatic teacher I had ever met in my life.
Your hand's on the mic.
Oh, sorry.
So you gotta do it again.
Start again and tell us why.
Bob Irwin was one of the most charismatic people I ever met in my life. And and that's what art school did to me. You know, it introduced me to a kind of charisma that was a style. It was a personal style of this group of people that, and it was totally infectious, at least to me. And there was a silliness in the whole thing that was absolutely charming.
Well, I would have to say that your style is pretty infectious. No, but your style and your sense of fashion from day one has obviously been kind of a part of...
My teacher in fashion was Bankston. Bankston was the slickest dude I'd ever met in my life, and he still is. But we used to go to thrift stores and look for bargains, you know, 2 for a nickel silk neckties from the Sulca company. And a lot of stuff was, a lot of clothes in the late 50s, there was a lot of great clothes from the 20s and the 30s and the 40s coming up into the thrift stores. Some of it was fantastic. And it was, of course, by the late 50s, already old style stuff, you know, and so there was lots of it. And we used to spend $3 or $4 a week on new suits and pairs of shoes. A pair of shoes would be 25 cents. And I still have a pair. Have you ever seen that picture that Dennis Hopper took of me in the striped pants with the black and white double wingtip spectators? I still have them. I paid a quarter for them at the Salvation Army store. And they were actually almost new when I got them, except that they had to have been at least 30 years old. There was no wear on the soles at all.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, Bankston, number one, talks so clearly about the artist persona and how you really had to have a style and a personality and put it out there so people would equate that with your work.
Well, I think, you know, it certainly worked for him in those times. He was the social director of the group, and Billy was close to a lot of Hollywood people and close to people that were close to Hollywood people, and there was nothing happening down here. Venice was totally dead. We used to go into town, go to hang out in Barney's Beanery. We all had studios down in Venice and Ocean Park, but nobody hung around down here. It was deadly dangerous at night. And there was no bars. There wasn't even a place to get a hamburger down here. And so we'd go in and sport it up at Musso and Frank's on occasion and go to Barney's Beanery practically every night. You know, that's where the social scene was. And the galleries were over there too, so a lot of stuff that had to do with that was sort of dealt with at the same time.
We were talking about Irwin before. What was it? What lessons? What was it that he imparted to you? Because I know that you only studied with him at the school for a year and a half.
I'll tell you what Bob's great strength was. In the few times that that I've done teaching, I've focused on trying to deliver the same kind of thing except in my language. And I think that what Bob did was actually give people the ability to trust themselves. And he made no judgments. His message was more about having faith in your wanting to do it. If you wanted to do it enough, you were going to do it. And school was only a vehicle for you to get through, to get to the point where you really wanted to do it. If you got to that point after 6 weeks, you were one of the fortunate ones because you didn't have to go through all the bullshit. But of course, you would then miss a lot of the social stuff that was equally important and other kinds of things. So to go off in your cave and do your thing immediately was not an unreasonable idea. At the same time, you missed a lot of good stuff that was happening, not just socially, but, you know, there are moments when an instructor is magical and he's and something takes another step. You know, finally, everybody has to learn how to do their own shit their own way after school. You know, and that's pretty much what Bob suggested. That, I mean, that to me, that's was his input. Because I was a very insecure kid in school. I came from a lower middle class Jewish family in the San Fernando Valley. That you know, just I was five when my parents moved out there in 1945, and so it was all farmland and. Oh, we're supposed to turn off our cell phones. I turned off mine. No texting either.
So yeah, so go back that you had moved with your family from Chicago.
Yeah, to the valley, and there was we moved into a small tract in Sherman Oaks, but right across the Los Angeles River, which was actually a river. It wasn't a big flood wash cement thing. It was a river with dirt sides that you walked down and could go fishing for crawdads down there. And that was, you know, what, two, three blocks north of Ventura Boulevard by Van Nuys Boulevard. That was the area, this little tract house built in the 20s or 30s. That Spanish kind of style, you know, and little place. And then, so I grew up in that neighborhood, but not long after we moved there, all of the farms and ranches and stuff disappeared. The land was being sold, built, developed for houses, and there was a housing shortage in Los Angeles right after the war, and that farm property was worth too much to not be have a house on it, but then it restricted where I could go as a kid. I could no longer ride my bike a few blocks away to the river and hang out with the other kids in the neighborhood down in the little secret forts we had, you know. It was a really pretty rural. Immediately, where the houses started, went into ranches and cornfields and watermelon patches and stuff like that.
But it also sounded like, you know, you had an undiagnosed hearing problem and you weren't doing so well at school, and it was difficult. You know, your parents.
Yeah, I didn't do well in early school either. I had trouble reading and. What I was going to say, well, all this was leading up to the fact that I couldn't go out and play very far anymore. And so about that same time, around 1947-48, my parents got a TV set. It was the first one on the street. And I spent an awful lot of my childhood in front of that thing. in lieu of going out. And
did you look at comic books?
Yeah, loved comic books. It was that kind of influence that got me into drawing cartoons and stuff in high school, because I really was not very attentive. I couldn't hear it very well, and so I lived in my head, in my own little world of stuff, you know.
And so at Chouinard at that point, in the, you know, in the art department there, you know, with Richard Druman and Wolfler, that the...
And Robert Chewy, don't forget that name, because he was a very powerful guy, and he was a great teacher and a fine man. There was a lot of political factions on abstract and not, you know, you had to learn how to draw the figure before you could get into abstract. Well, there was a lot of politics that had to do with opinions about things like that. Well, Chewy was not interested in that, even though he painted like Cezanne landscapes, giant things like that. But he didn't have any axes to grind, and I really liked that about the guy. And I admired how strong his paintings were, even though the goofy abstractions that the other instructors were doing, I found more engaging, or more charming, maybe. This guy's mastery of what he could do with realistic kind of landscapes was pretty amazing, and I had a lot of respect for that guy, and he was a good teacher. And
I mean, that's what I was just going to ask you, was that the style at that point was to teach more abstract expressions, right?
And no. Irwin did not teach abstract expressionism. Richard Rubin did not teach abstract expressionism. Excuse me. Emerson Wolfer did not teach abstract expressionism. They were all abstract expressionistic painters. But the way they approached their teaching was that people came in and did their stuff. You brought in your materials and you started working on something, unless there was a specific challenge like a still life or a model or something like that, which on occasion each and every one of those guys brought in or set up a still life of bottles like a Mirandi or something like that. And some people slashed away at it with big brushes, and some people tried to render the view, whatever it was, very carefully. And Irwin and Rubin and Wolfer simply addressed issues that were relevant in the mechanics of the business. Oh, you know, this is a little sloppy over here or something like that, or, you know, it's because you can't, where's the edge, or, you know, maybe you want to have a contrast or something like that. But it wasn't about her tits are too big or not big enough. It wasn't that you can't tell if you have to do better hands or any of that kind of stuff. It was just matter of fact, personal opinion of looking at something that they were doing themselves, except their imagery was different. And since most of the students that were really interested in what their teachers, you know, they studied up on what their teachers did, and so they were obviously influenced in some manner by that. I had a teacher there also named Herb Jepson, who was a big time teacher at Chouinard in those years, and he taught drawing. And in fact, he never told anybody how to draw, but everybody drew exactly the same way. Around the walls, pinned up on the walls of his rooms, were years worth of students' drawings, and they all looked like the the stuff that, so the people took their cue on how to draw from the, from what was around. And Jepson would talk about mystical stuff. He'd wander through the room just rapping about this and that, sort of putting you in a hypnotic state to draw and feel the drawing. And, you know, I mean, he talked about stuff. He on occasion would sit down at somebody's drawing thing and noodle out a knee or something based on the model. But he mostly just talked. Even when he did that, he would say, you know, may I sit down? And he would work into somebody's thing, but he'd carry on his conversations about this other stuff, you know. That was actually a key moment for me at Chouinard, because when I realized that Jepson wasn't talking about drawing in the manner that everybody was drawing, he never told anybody how to do that stuff. They came in with the same kind of oatmeal paper and their washes and their ink line stuff and whatever, and because that's what everything on the wall was. And so, but he never once said anything about how to do this stuff. And I realized that he was talking about a whole different kind of a thing than, he was talking about something more akin to what Irwin was talking about, which was trust the feeling of the line, trust it. As long as you trust it, there's strength in it, okay? And that's when I started drawing squares, little squares on paper, and following this this kind of train of thought that the guy had, that you had to feel the drawing. Well, the easiest thing for me to do was to draw something that related to the square page I worked on, and forget the model and all of that kind of stuff. Forget all of this washy style and ink and stuff like that. You could do it with chalk, and you could do it with anything. And he ultimately sent me to a shrink that the school had hired to weed out the weirdos, and that's when I quit Chouinard.
Yeah, you told us that story when we...
Yeah. But
let's talk about the development of your work, because that is really interesting, especially early on, you know, that you started doing...
Somewhere I have a whole one of those portfolios filled with a lot of those squares of drawings from Jepson's class. I thought it was profoundly important what the discovery I had made, and he thought I was crazy. So it was time for me to leave school.
But it sounded like you got wonderful lessons from the people there, and you had lifelong friends, and
look,
you got everything that you wanted out.
I am celebrating my 51st year of unemployment. I've never had a fucking job. I've never had to work for anybody. I've just done my thing. I can't imagine life being any better than that. There have been really hard times, and then there's been fat times, but in fact, through the lean and the fat, I've managed to do what I wanted to do, take care of my family and all of that. And all because I spent a little less than 2 years at Chouinard and had these wonderful people that influenced me, you know. So I really believe in art school. I believe that that when Chouinard tried to reestablish itself in Los Angeles, I tried to help, even though I didn't want to be a teacher. I was trying to be supportive of the people raising the money and doing all that stuff, you know. I don't have the discipline to sit in on meetings very much, but anyways, I thought it was very important, because for me it was important.
when you said you, I want, that was one of the things I did want to cover, because back during the college years and around the early time, you did have a bunch of jobs.
Oh, yeah. But most of it had to do with chasing girls.
And working at different bars.
Mm-hmm. Where you chased girls.
It's all about the girls.
It's all about girls, Rani.
But tell us about the job at the Unicorn Bar. Or tell us, like, what was, like, L.A. like, that whole club scene and everything?
Well, I was not that interested in the club scene. I liked the Unicorn because it was a folk music club, and I liked folk music. And there was a time in my life during art school when I played the guitar and worked at this club also, and then after school I kept stayed on the job, and part of my job was play the guitar, sing folk songs in the back, in the little courtyard. If I wasn't seating people or being a bouncer or some, you know, or mopping the toilet where somebody threw up, you know, I mean, I did everything that was to be done there, and just because I liked it. I wasn't much of a club goer except for Barney's, and which I wouldn't exactly call a club. It was more a neighborhood bar, and. But the Unicorn was a club. It was a folk music club, and you sat down for drinks and entertainment. In those days, so they only had espresso and, you know, soft drinks and pastries and stuff like that. So it didn't even qualify as a bar.
One of the things we're going to be covering is kind of what the cultural scene in L.A., and one of the characters that comes up is Lenny Bruce.
Well, I was lucky. During the time I worked there, Lenny played at the club a couple of times, two or three different sessions, and I worked the door, in other words, letting people, seating people, bringing them in, seating them. There was a guy who collected a dollar admission at the door. Lenny's fee for performing there was the dollar that they collected at the door. The club got nothing from that. All the club got was the bar service. Well, Lenny's fans came out of the woodwork for every night that he was there. I mean, the place was packed, and they were all junkies. These guys could nurse a 50-cent espresso for 3 weeks, you know. So they had set up the performance schedule. So Lenny did his first set at 8:30, would be over at 9:30. At 10, there'd be another set, and so on. And they'd maybe squeeze three performances in the night. Lenny was all for it as long as the gate was his. But the first set on that first night that he performed, at 11:30 he was still on his first set, and there were people round the block getting really pissed because the place, you could hear the laughter coming out of this place for blocks,
But what was it about Lenny that was so potent?
He was funny. Have you never heard any of his records? He was just funny. They're still funny. And he was so spontaneous and had this great face that he made his eyes do all kinds of funny stuff when he told stories. And he had a kind of a beatnik style about him too. It was sort of a easy style until he'd get really riled into some kind of great anecdote about something that would be hysterical. And a lot of it was political. Actually, all of it probably was political.
Were you political at all?
No. No, but the humor of it all didn't escape me. Just you know, I was not political.
Can we go back in time?
Uh-oh.
And go back to kind of more the development of your work?
What about Lenny Bruce?
Did you have more about Lenny?
Yeah.
What's
the best part of the story?
Which is?
Well, finally, the owner and the manager came down. They flashed the lights to try and get him off the stage, and he still wouldn't. Everything they did, he made into part of his routine, you know. Finally, they just turned off the lights, and they went up on the stage and dragged him off the stage, and he went into this bit like he was being taken to the electric chair, you know, and they dragged him out of the theater and around through the bar and then up to the office, and nobody left. And the people outside were getting really pissed. And I went upstairs, I said to the owner, the owner and the manager were standing next to a chair with Lenny in it, and they were both looking at him like this, and Lenny was in the chair like this. I said, whispered to the owner, Herb Cohen, "Herbie, nobody's left." And he said, "Okay, let's go downstairs." And we went downstairs, and he looks around, looks at the place. He says, "Did you bring your guitar?" I said, "Yeah. It's in the car." He says, "Do a set." So I went and got my guitar, and I cleared the house before the first song.
Instead of warming him up, you warmed him down.
I got him right out of there.
Well,
now we can go back in
good.
Time.
I just wanted to make sure we covered the different phases, because when we talked to you last time about, like, you know, the paintings that you'd made for War Babies, you know, and you mentioned previously that the image of the square, I mean, tell us, the work that you were doing then was like acrylic, like large-scale acrylic on canvas.
Oil.
So just maybe start by telling us, you know, some of that early work and the development of the pieces into three dimensions.
Well, the Lenny Bruce story is funnier. I started painting these big kind of abstract expressionistic pictures. There's a photo of a piece from that period in the book. And it was oil on paper. I did a lot of paintings on paper. And they were pretty simple, kind of, most of the paintings were related to the shape of the canvas. Most of the canvases were slightly rectangular, I painted these bars that enclosed the central area of the canvas and tried to work with the edges of the paint and make it interesting between the edge and the center of the things and so on. And the edges got harder and less colors. And then I started doing some images that suggested volumes. And those were pretty interesting, so I decided to just paint the volumes. And then I decided to make the shape of the canvas suggest the volume and paint some other thing with one color to suggest another volume within this volume. And I didn't do that many of those things, but they were pretty interesting, I thought, and they were easy to look at, which I liked. But they were illustrations of volumes. And I was not that interested in anymore in making pictures of things, which is what I saw. The paintings were pictures of space or something like that. And I should try and make the volumes. And that's when I became a sculptor. And in one of the last paintings I incorporated a thick piece of clear glass into the center of it. And so you could see the wall when the thing was hanging up there. And I liked glass. When I had a little job at a picture framing place, and I kept that job because I could buy my art supplies, my paints and stuff, wholesale from the guy. And the work was pretty easy. I learned how to cut glass and to frame things and so on. And in my spare time in the store, he had a big box full of bargain frames and things that he sold to people for a dollar. And amongst them were these little shadow boxes made of maple. And I used to take those and make little empty boxes with glass and paper and stuff. Some of them I painted on and in, and some of them I put mirrors in and scraped away the mirror and took the chips of scraped mirror and apply it to the edge. So all of the stuff that I started with was still there, but it was in a different form, you know. And without realizing it, I had gone from being a painter to a sculptor.
So that transition, I mean, like we would say, like Little Orphan Annie is a shaped canvas.
Mm-hmm.
And was it Conrad Hoff that was the piece?
Yes.
So maybe you can use those two as examples of that transition.
Well, I really can't, because the Little Orphan Annie was actually the first big painting I did. And Conrad Hawk was the last. And so in the period of a year or two while doing this stuff, from 60 to 62 or something like that, a lot of stuff took place in my head, a lot of formalizing of ideas of approach. I had also done some pieces with mirrors in glass, some canvas, some paintings that had mirrors that I had scraped away the backing to create a pattern. The patterns were always illustrative of the volume of the shape. Yeah.
Are we good?
Yeah, sure. Her piece is very nice, strong, clear. All the writing is good except for mine.
Well, you don't have to really worry about that part.
I'm not. I don't worry about hardly anything anymore.
So we were talking about that period, 60 to 62, when you were...
Then I worried.
moving from some of the shape canvases into the first pieces that incorporated bits of glass and mirror.
Yeah, yeah.
And you were using the idea of volume. You mentioned that word several times.
Well, the pictures, the paintings, in my mind, were kind of illustrations of volumes, and I just decided to try and make the volumes instead of make illustrations of the volumes. But the first ones that I did actually had pictures of volumes on them, where I used the same technique of scratching away mirroring on a piece of glass and to make a tessera shape or something like that, that was an illustration of a flat diagram of a cubic volume, things like that, or elliptical patterns or things that had a a spatial reference, a volume reference to them. When I think of an ellipse shape, I think of the galaxy of Andromeda. And it pulls on us from a roughly 40-degree angle. And so that's a 40-degree angle, on, that's a 40-degree ellipse. And so it's a huge volume. And it's, to me, the elliptical form suggests a huge volume. And the cubic form suggests a smaller volume. And there's kind of an intimacy in the cube that, the way I worked with it, that allowed me to play around with something that I had never, it never occurred to me was a media, was light. And the fact that a piece of glass absorbed light, reflected light, and transmitted light all at the same time. This was a phenomena that I noticed when I made a little construction when I worked in the frame shop, where I put a piece of cracked glass in this box, and when I held it up like to hang it on the wall, I saw the reflection of the glass, I mean the reflection of the crack of the glass, the shadow of the crack of the glass, and the crack itself. So there were three lines that were created by this thing and the light. And I that piece is in the French show, and I suspect that's the most important piece in the show for that set the tone for a lot of work that was to come. After I did that piece, I actually went on to do paintings and had that abstract expressionistic stuff. It was just something that I did. And
which piece was that?
Huh?
Which piece was that?
It's in that book. Where's
right, what's the name?
What's it called?
Doesn't have a name.
It's just an untitled piece.
It's a.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
okay.
It's in the front of the book. There's a picture. No, keep going. Somewhere.
Keep going. I think I know what you mean.
Okay,
it's somewhere in there. It's in
it's
that.
This one.
No, but it was one of those kind of boxes that's made out of.
Okay. Well,
I'm
let's,
sorry.
Let's keep,
maybe
okay,
it's not
I'm sorry,
in there.
I didn't realize it wasn't. It was untitled.
Most of these photos illustrate the texts, various texts, but I think there's a,
there
the one, yeah. That's the one, and that's the crack and the shadow of the crack and the reflection of the crack.
Okay. But the idea we were talking about, like the illusion of cubic space and going into something that's more physical, I mean, that is a development that happened and you started working on, did that kind of transition into the cubes?
Yeah. That was a transition.
Well, just to step back, you made shape canvases.
Yes.
And of course, those were objects in themselves.
Yeah, I didn't think of them as such. I just thought of them as paintings or as diagrams. And I thought that the reason I did that shape of canvas was because it reminded me of a flat diagram, a flat space of a cubic volume, and the paintings that I did inside there were simple one color to alter the shape, the image of the space that was illustrated by the stretcher bar canvas. A simple shape went off of that shape that was inherent in the canvas and gave another volume using the architecture of the canvas plane. But I didn't think of them as objects. I thought of them as paintings and or pictures of volumes. And so my plan was to get away from making pictures or illustrations of volumes and make the volumes themselves. You had noticed in that book of the, you asked about the aquarium and stuff. That was one of the few pieces that I made that were sculptural, but they were the shape of the tessera. And you know, I was sort of fine, but they were objects that sat out on something in the center of the room and had weight and mass, which were quite different than the weight and mass of the canvases, and they required a lot of hands-on facturing, they were sculptures, period, and not very good ones, but they were a step away from the wall, but came right out of that wall stuff. They were illustrations now of the paintings in a weird way. They were three-dimensional sculptural shapes representing the paintings that I just tried to do. But what was really there was this volume, this illustration, this desire within the work to become a real volume and not the image of a volume, even if it had volume. It was just still a picture of another thing. And so I went to the thing and made cubes.
So what was the first cube that you made? And did you where did you get your material?
The first actual cube construction I made was, you may have seen it around here, I called it L. Bell's house. It was made from mirrors I bought at the thrifty drugstore and scraped away the patterns to, and then where I'd scraped away the mirror, I painted black epoxy paint on it so there was mirror and black and mirror and black to define an image or something. And it was very arduous work. It was not very interesting work, and I mean the making of it. I think the piece still has its charm, but making it was a giant pain in the ass, and I screwed up right and left with things. And in fact, the black paint that I put on after I scraped off the stuff on the back was put on to clean up edges that I thought didn't look very good. And so it was a struggle getting through that thing. But when I finished it, it was just what I sort of thought it was going to end up being. But I had to find an easier way to get to this point. There probably were 80 or more pieces of glass and 4 pieces of wood in that construction, and it weighed a ton. And all of those pieces of glass were thin layers of glass, so it couldn't even support its own weight. I had to. I kept cracking the bottom strips because its own weight just was too much for it, you know. But the thing actually held together pretty good all these years. The few cracks that happened on the bottom are still there. Not on the bottom of the plane, but the frame, this kind of clunky frame that ended up being made out of mirrored strips also. But then I that led me to the search for somebody that could make a mirror with a pattern on it where I didn't have to put 2 pieces of mirror that I'd scraped away the pattern exactly the same back to back. And so I wanted a reflection of a pattern to go both directions and the light to pass through in certain ways. Well, I wanted one piece of glass to do that, and that's when I discovered this vacuum coating process that became invaluable to me to play around with this kind of stuff.
Let's go back to what the effect. Now, when you scrape away the mirror coating, right, the glass becomes see-through again.
Yeah.
Is that right?
Right.
So, you describe the different kinds of processes going on in some of those early cubes.
Describe what?
Well, part of it is, it's this really interesting play to me, but I'd like to hear in your words, between what you see through, what reflects back, and what you painted black that stops your vision.
Well, the black paint was more of a band-aid to the visuals of the thing for me. I didn't like the black paint other than the fact that it cleaned up stuff pretty well. And if you look in that book, you'll find a picture of the piece Al Bell's house, and you can see how the black was used to define the lines of the two mirrors that were back to back. I had to paint those stripes down the same on both parts too. And then on the opaque sides of the thing, it was a way of not having to look at the wood or the number of cracked panels that were underneath because when something broke, I just laminated another thing on top of it.
And how about the play between reflection and...
Oh, I liked it. That was the idea of doing the double reflection. The inside of the box was lined with mirrors, and so they reflect the one on the bottom and the sides. They reflected kind of an infinite space in the interior, and I wanted that same feeling to be on the two visual sides that you actually could get light through. And they did the same kind of thing too, except that the because of the pattern, the patterns in the sides and top and bottom, the light just reflected the empty volume, but on the, let's call it the front and the back of the piece, there was a pattern that was reflected, and it was an illustration of that tessera shape. Oh my God.
I don't know what it is.
It's my cigar.
Oh, it just appeared.
Thank you, Ronnie.
But we can go back to, you know, your search then for somebody to help you make a little bit more of a pristine form and the vacuum coating. And it told us at one point that you found some guy who did the optical.
Yeah, he did most of his work for the studios, making special mirrors for the studios, and Disney Studios was not far from him, and Warner Brothers. And
well, could you start again? What was the name of the company?
Keim Precision Mirrors. His name was Gordon Keim, the man who did it. And it was a small store. I looked him up in the yellow, because somebody had told me about something called front surface mirrors, and I looked it up in the yellow pages of the phone book, and it listed this guy's name. I phoned the number and I said, I'm looking for a piece of glass that's reflective on both sides. And he said, well, I've got it. And I went over there and he reached under the counter and pulled out this little square of mirror, and it was a mirror on both sides. And I asked him, can you put a pattern on this? He said, sure. I said, how do you do that? He said, I don't know, you mask it off somehow. I said, like with masking tape? And he said, no, you can't use masking tape because it gases. You have to use something that doesn't give off a lot of gas, because I've got to get all the gas out of... I had no idea what the technique was. He never took me in the back room to see his equipment or how he did it. And I ultimately did it with silk screen. I silk screened a pattern onto the glass, and then he metallized it, and then we wash off the pattern that I had screened on, and it did, and there was the mirroring the way I wanted it. And it was all on one piece of glass, so that was the main thing. The coating was on the inside, protected by the wall of glass, and so if I was careful, I could get these things assembled, and the units themselves would be much less weight, much less cumbersome. I could work faster, and if I screwed up, though, it was a much more expensive resolution to it than just going to the drugstore and buying a $1.99 mirror.
And that must have opened up a whole new...
It did indeed.
Is that what you, was that your second show at Ferris? The, were those the?
Yes, the second show at Ferris.
We didn't even, we haven't even mentioned Ferris yet.
No. Do you want to mention Ferris now?
Yeah, sure.
Well, in 1960, actually, I thought I was getting going to get drafted in 1961, and I couldn't see any reason why I wasn't going to get drafted. Everybody else that I knew from high school was getting sent off to Vietnam, so I was doing those paintings, and I went to all my buddies showed with the Ferris Gallery. I wanted to show with them. I went to Walter and Irving at the time, and I said, or was it just Walter? I don't know. But I said, I wanted to do a show, and they hadn't seen my work. They came by and said, okay, you can have a show. And so I got a show in 62 at the paintings. And then in 63, I had already moved into the constructions, and I didn't get drafted, it turned out. The relationship just carried on until they closed.
Well, you were quite literally the youngest of all of the Ferris artists. How did that feel?
Well, for me it felt great, you know, but I had respect for the elders of the group. Bankston and Kenny weren't that much older than me, but Irwin and Altoon and whoever else was there then, they were all older. Keenholz and they were all older. Yeah, Ed. I didn't know Ed then, though. I didn't meet Ed till around 62 or something like that. He had just gotten married and came back from Spain. And so I didn't know Ed during the formative day school time. Or
can you watch out with the chair, because I'm feeling it's probably
It's, oh my God.
You only just started doing
I just can't do anything right today.
No.
You got up through a whole hour without doing it.
So it's good. Was Billy the star in the early days?
Oh yeah. Yeah. He was the leader of the pack.
And what did that
mean? Rightly so. He just had a nose for fun and knew all kinds of people outside of our little world and brought us all into it. Everybody was welcome. You know, if they were friends of Bankston's, they were welcome. And he knew all kinds of people in the film business and music, and I don't know, just an exotic group of ambitious, creative people in another world. And,
But that must have been a really, you know, heady time, that the shows at Ferris, and you were selling work, and your work was getting moved.
I didn't sell much at Ferris. I don't really remember. Maybe I sold one thing in all of the shows I did. I can't remember. Not very much of anything. I didn't sell anything until I teamed up with the Pace Gallery. And the first show sold everything before it even opened. At least that's what Arnie told me when I went in the day of the show. He says, well, we really don't have to have the opening. Why? Yeah, I've sold everything.
I mean, that's pretty incredible. You, out of, you know, pretty much the entire group, had success in New York, and, you know, you moved to New York at some point.
Yeah, right after that. I decided I hadn't sold shit, and all of a sudden he sold everything before the show even opened. This is a place I better hang out in for a while, you know. And but there were other circumstances that introduced me to the technology that I had paid somebody else to do, and I had the opportunity to acquire some equipment and learn how to do it, and it seemed like the right moment to do that, and the gallery encouraged me to stay in New York and gave me money to rent a little place and do my thing there, and I'm still thankful to them for that opportunity, and I had a great time. I got to know a lot of wonderful people that are, some of them are still very close friends, and saw some fantastic artists. They showed some incredible people that were totally different from the things that I was interested in. Paul Tech comes to mind because he was one of their artists early on, and his things were so strange, and he was such a sweet guy and so unbelievably skilled, and his things were so grisly and awful looking, you know, that I just thought they were incredible.
I wanted to go back because that moment in New York was a real important transition, that, and you can give us the story, that at one point objects that you had shipped had come to New York and they were broken.
Yeah. Well, that's how I got it was for my first show at Pace, and I got there a couple of weeks early. The work got there a couple of weeks early, and when we opened the boxes at the gallery, several pieces were broken, and I mentioned to the gallery that there was a chance we could repair these things if I could find a glass guy that could do the work and somebody do the coatings on the glass, and they said, you find them and we'll back it. Which they did, and that's what introduced me to the equipment and the technique, and the first guy that I actually saw do it, and what the equipment looked like, and all of that.
That's the story. Tell me about Ionic Research Company.
Ionic Research Labs.
Dr. Koenig, how did you find it?
Dr. Koenig, again in the phone book. And
Ionic Research Labs.
Yeah. I needed to find somebody that could coat the glass, and I looked in the yellow pages of the Manhattan phone direct, New York phone book, and I found under vacuum coating, because I knew the name of the process from the guy out here who did it, and I found a company called Ionic Research Labs, and I phoned the number and explained what I wanted to do, and this guy with a heavy German accent says, yeah, we can do it. Come on down. So so I took a taxi down to Longfellow Avenue, number 541, and in the Bronx, it was not too far from the old produce market. And walked into this huge, it's like a Quonset hut that was
up in the Bronx near the produce market.
Yeah, and there was just this Longfellow Avenue was a street full of these giant Quonset huts, like airplane hangars, you know. The taxi stops at this place, and the front door was open. It was winter, it was cold. There were these big trash cans outside with fires going in them, you know, and it was black inside. The big door was open, and you couldn't see anything inside. It was just this black hole. And I walked in to the place because it was the address. The sign said Ionic Research Labs, and when my eyes adjusted to how poor the light was, I could see there was a whole army of people scurrying around pushing carts full of stuff, and there was a row of these tanks on the side of the room, and a voice rings out from somewhere saying, Bell, are you Bell? I said, yes, looking around, and there was a sort of a old-fashioned watch box, you know, a little teeny office about the size of a big phone booth with a desk in it and glass all around. And up there was Dr. Benjamin Koenig, who ran Ionic Research Labs. And he says, come on up. I walk up to this little place and he's eating these two, he's got these two hot dogs with sauerkraut on his desk, you know, and takes a bite of one. He says, this is living. And he says, what can I do for you? And I explained to him I was an artist and I had some sculptures made of glass that had been damaged and I wanted to color the, recoat the glass, some panel, get some glass done. And he says, yeah, we can do it, we can do it, no problem. When do you want to do it? And I said, well, I've got to, just knowing that you are, your facility can do it, you know, he wanted to know what the coatings were and all that, and I didn't know. I had to call the other guy and find out what the deal was. And so I got back to him and found the glass company, which ironically was right across the street from the building that was to become Don Judd's studio on Spring and Green. A man named William Lyons, a sweet old guy, had been in the glass business for ever and ever and down in that area. He made the parts for me. And I scheduled the meeting and I took the glass up there to be coated. But then it occurred to me, you know, that the place that I saw, oh, I should go back a bit to my first meeting with the guy. And I asked him, what do you do here? Because I couldn't tell what these people were doing, you know. And he says, decorative metallizing. And I said, well, what do you metallize? He says, well, for some company, he says, we do 40 million glass globes for Christmas ornaments. And for the Hubley Toy Company, we coat 6 million cap pistols a year for them, you know. And he says, come on, I'll show you. And he takes me down, and these big tanks were vacuum coaters that were what they call batch coaters, where they had a fixture inside that a whole bunch of cap pistols would go, be hooked into. And this huge round thing would roll into the tank, and each one of these rows that had maybe 50 cap pistols on it would turn this way as the whole thing turned in the tank. And the evaporation took place in the center of the tank on a fixture that held aluminum to be evaporated. And all the stuff spun around a central, it's called a planetary jig. And the stuff all spun around while the evaporation took place and got coated on all its parts. And he did the same thing with the little glass balls that he put on stuff, and that would then be dipped into dye, different dyes for red Christmas bulbs and green Christmas bulbs and stuff like that. And that's what, that was his business. And it occurred to me that the surface of the glass was really important. The guy knew that the guy in Burbank that did the coating had to scrupulously clean the stuff, because before I brought it into him, he told me to clean that stuff up as much as they could, because there wasn't a great deal they could do to clean the masked off parts and stuff like that. So I was conscious of the fact that it had to be clean. And when I actually did bring the glass into him, I had taken it up to my hotel room and washed each piece very carefully. But not really knowing what it meant to wash a piece of glass at the time. And wrapped each one in paper and brought this stack of stuff down to him. And he had an assistant named Philip Gargiulo from Napoli, who was a very funny character, and Philip made up the fixturing that would hold the glass for me in, inside the tank, and he made the, since he understood the process and knew what we had to do to get this stuff clean and I mean, get the coatings on it the way I wanted it, they did it. And he charged me $1,000 for this day of working with them, which was a shitload of money in 1965. And he said to me, because we had had three or four meetings before, so I got to know the guy a little bit before I actually brought the parts in. And he said, you know, it's just crazy for you to spend this kind of money. I can imagine how much the optical coater is charging you out there for doing this. Why don't you get the equipment and do it yourself? I told him I had not any experience with anything. I didn't know anything. He says, there's nothing to it. And I have an old system that I'll sell you cheap. It'll do your job for you. You won't have to pay anybody to do this stuff, blah, blah, blah. And he sold me a Kinney P5 coater that was probably, in 1965, it was probably close to 20 years old. And but in fact, it was a very efficient piece of hardware. And I learned. And then I bought the equipment. Philip brought it down one weekend, and we drug it inside and hooked it all up. And I had the power all ready and waiting for it, and bolted it down to the floor so the pumps wouldn't vibrate and walk around. And it was a big horse, and nothing like what I have now, but it was big. And then I didn't hear from him for about 10 days, and was just sitting in the studio there looking at this thing, not having the slightest idea what it was and how it worked. And finally I called the guy, got really pissed, and said, you really pulled a number on me, didn't you? You know, he says, what are you talking about? I said, you're too enthusiastic. This is, you know, you can get hurt here. I'm sending somebody down. No, I've got ahead of myself in the story. He comes down. Dr. Koenig comes down to look at the thing installed, and it was a freezing, blizzardy day, and he's all in this bearskin coat with one of those Russian hats, and, you know, he was a little guy, and he walks in and he says, yeah, this will do very nice. And I said, well, great, Dr. Koenig, when do I get my first lesson? He says, right now. And he reaches into his overcoat and pulls out this book called Vacuum Deposition of Thin Films. And he just stuck it in my stomach and says, you start on page one, and turned and walked out. Well, I was stunned and pissed. I phoned him up the next day and I said, well, you really pulled a number on me. And he says, don't be mad. You're too enthusiastic. You get burned around here. But I'm sending a guy down who used to work for you, that worked for me, that he's an outpatient from the Jacoby Tubercular Clinic. He's a living dead man, but he really knows this stuff, and he could use the money. You'll pay him $20 for each visit and pay his cab fare both ways. And okay. And this guy shows up named Mike Glicksman. And we started on page one, and he explained to me what the equipment was in relation to the passages in the book that were important, and what what we were trying to do and what the process was all about. And we found an old Coke bottle in the building, and he says, we're going to metallize this first. And we just stuck it in this thing, and he set it all up, and it all worked. And I was just beside myself. I was so excited. And he came down every week on Tuesdays and Thursdays. And I was playing around with the techniques that he showed me the time before, you know, and doing a lot of evaporation tests. And this was a real basic system where you had to close valves in sequence and open other valves and stuff like that. And I always got myself screwed up which valves to open and close. In the beginning, it was really clumsy, and I screwed up the thing a whole bunch of times. But I had to take it apart and clean it out. But I learned a lot about, you know, how the simplicity of this stuff, but the procedures were very important, and that you didn't do the wrong thing at the wrong time.
But that's fascinating because, you know, here you are, we're in LA, and you had to go to this guy who would do all the work for you and never even let you in the back room, and then here you go to New York, and this guy really takes you under his wing, and...
Yeah. I love New York. It was always good to me, you know, the memories of those times now are, you know, very warming. I had a good time in New York. It's where I really got to know Chamberlain, and although I had met him here a couple of years earlier, I really got to know him there, and Neil Williams, and all these crazy guys that used to hang out at Mickey's. It's where I met de Kooning, I walked into Max's one night, and Mickey Ruskin, the owner, says, "Hey, John and Neil are over in the corner with a couple of other bozos," and the two other bozos were de Kooning and William Burroughs.
That's some bozos. And at one point, John came to L.A.?
Yeah, in 62. That's where I first met him. And I helped get him a studio on the same street that my studio was on. And he and Neil came out with him to help him make some stuff.
Which street? Where?
Marine Street. But it doesn't exist anymore on this side of Pacific. It's something else now. They tore down all of the old hotels and stuff that were there. It was just, at the end of Marine was POP, the amusement pier, Ocean Park Amusement Pier. And,
it's kind of near where the Bros Contemporary is?
That's the street.
Yeah.
That's Marine Street.
Yeah,
that was the telephone switching station.
We do have a lot to cover, but I think, Larry, what we're going to do is I'm going to ask you a handful of just straightforward questions.
I have somebody coming at 4:30, so.
What time is it now?
10 after.
Okay.
You can
so
do it.
One thing is that this is the painting of John Altoons that we're showing in our exhibition.
Uh-huh.
And it would be great if you could start by telling, you know, after you look it's one of the Ocean Park theories, and maybe you can just give us a little bit of an overview of John, you know, and maybe talk in particular about this painting and that series of work.
Well, John painted real fast, and John painted really fast, and he was totally intuitive and spontaneous when he painted these things. I don't think this is one of the better paintings from this period. I'd have to see the real thing. I don't know what else to tell you. It's a fun picture. And that was the period that we were on Marine Street, 62.
So
most people really think of John as a draftsman.
Uh-huh.
How do you feel the drawings versus the paintings?
Well, you can see his drawing here, you know. It's like this is his drawing and this is his painting. And I have memories of some of the great paintings that were, they all seem to have dog images in them. He had a neutered female dog called Man, and Man was always humping his leg, and
all right, well, let's we can let that go.
Okay. Sorry, John.
Okay. Tell me, we want to have a little section on Jack Brogan. So could you tell me a little bit about your relationship with Jack?
Well, I
start by saying his name.
Jack Brogan is somebody I've known for a long time, but I met him through Irwin. He was doing some of these scrim kind of things and helping Bob figure out how to do the, I think that's what when I first met him. And Jack Brogan, I met Jack through Bob Irwin. I believe it was during the time that Bob was doing these stretch scrim pieces. And it may have been a piece for the Museum of Modern Art in New York. We were all in a show. We were in a show together. I think it was called Spaces, or something like that. And Bob's piece was mounted in a stairwell. And the other people had sort of traditional gallery spaces. And I actually didn't get to know Jack as a and his wondrous talents as a fabricator until some years ago when he was had a repair on one of my cubes to do and asked me if I could help him with some parts. As it turned out, I'm a pack rat, and in the times that I made the cubes, I've always had spare parts that I kept, and I was able to just replace the damaged parts with parts from the same group of things done originally, and that helped him a lot, and we just became good friends.
We were talking about spaces. One of the things, you know, we're showing, and that's the beginnings of environmental or installation art. But to go just before that, when by the time you started making the 40-inch cubes, those are pretty much environmental pieces, and they kind of dominate the room.
Yeah, they do. But I wasn't thinking of them as environmental pieces, really, at the time. I was thinking of them as sculptures, just larger cube. I make stuff to look at, for me to look at. There's a kind of a tactile challenge in the mechanics of doing these things, whether they're small or big. If they're real small, I like real small ones, but they're real hard to get inside to clean out and stuff like that. And I like real big ones, but they're real hard to clean out too. And I like to get them clean at least once when in the beginning, and close them up, and then look at them and see what they do. And I learned a lot from the first big ones from around 1970. I was able to eliminate the framing on some of them that I did. And And that was a big step for me because the form just was there and wasn't contained with any metal kind of trim. And part of the reason for the trim in the first place was to cover up choppy edges and stuff, poor glue joints and so on. And so I was obliged to learn how to make the pieces so that they didn't have those chopped up edges and sloppy glue joints. But I didn't think of those pieces as environmental. Interestingly, the show I just did in France, I did a new installation made of two old pieces. One is a 40-inch cube that's owned by the Stedelijk from that period, and a piece that's owned by the museum in Lyon. So I took this big box from the Stedelijk and put it symmetrically in the center of a beautiful space, and then set this a box around it that was reflective, a gradient reflective from the floor up. It got thinner, okay? So the base for this big cube was occluded by the mirroring on the outside, so this thing sort of floated in the center of the space. And we lit the floor with patches, square patches of light that were exactly the same distance from the outside of the glass as the cube was from the inside of the glass. So the reflection of the square of light on each of the four sides was reflected into the, it appeared to be sitting where the cube was sitting, but the cube was the cube was very hard to see in the way that we lit the all the ambient light in the room came from the floor, from the four patches of light and their reflection. And it was a beautiful environment. I mean, it was a beautiful environment. And it would have been ridiculous to try and put anything else in that room. The room was part of the piece, you know. And when I got into doing the bigger walls, they were hopefully to be presented in a room with nothing else except the walls, and I could light the walls and the floor to make the space, to change the room and make it interesting.
Just to go back, I mean, when you moved from, well, I think it was, what, about 24 by 24 cubes to 40 by 40, what was, because it seems there's always like a new challenge from your work. What was the challenge?
How to hold it together. That was the challenge. What kind of glue would hold this stuff together, be sort of invisible and strong enough so that the thing could be moved after it was assembled? And how to get it square, you know, how to get it at least square enough to assemble it. And I had made up some fixturing, some jigs that were a series of corners that stuff slid into, and I had these little Teflon pegs that would hold it so the glass didn't move once it was laid into position. And then I put the glue on and let it cure. I would assemble three pieces of glass at once, the bottom and two corners to a piece. And then if they then pull that out of the jig and turn it around so that the open sides faced those walls that were part of this three-sided device, and drop in the other two panels and glue them in place. And that gave me five sides affixed together. The question was, how square was it? It had to be a square enough for the top piece to fit in and not fall inside and not stick out somewhere, you know. We're pretty good at it, actually, considering that the parts were probably not square. And I mean, the fudge factor was great on these pieces, and I didn't mind fudging in the least just to get through the lesson.
I mean, when you got that, the cubes got that big, what were some of the visual effects that you got that you couldn't get in the smaller ones?
There weren't many, actually. There was a kind of density. Most of the big ones were black, were dark glass. I made them out of dark glass so that the detritus that was going to end up inside it wasn't that visible. And they had a more ominous kind of presence to them than the smaller ones, which had more light in them. These were very solid, kind of dense things. There were a few very light ones made, big ones made, but they were very, very difficult to clean. And in the clear ones, I had to frame them all. I couldn't get away with the. It was too much light, and so little things bothered me a lot then. Blob of glue where it wasn't supposed to be seen, a seam that didn't really look like it came together right. You could see that with the clear glass that was coated, but not with the dark glass that was coated. So it was practical. I did make a few big clear ones. I remember they were a struggle. They were a constant struggle. And when I finished them, I wasn't that happy with them. It's a lot of work for something that wasn't that personally rewarding.
We're showing the 40-inch cube.
Uh-huh. I hope it gets there okay.
How did you tell us?
Is that the only one you're showing? Is that?
No. We have the wall piece, which we'll talk about in a second. But before we talk about the wall piece, Michael Strauss's piece. Tell us about the base and how and what height you like the work, the 40-inch cube, to be shown, because that was different than some of the smaller pieces.
Yeah. Well, the base for your piece should be about 12 inches or 14 inches tall, so that the piece sits at 50 to 52, 54 inches at the top from the floor.
And is that to give somebody...
It's so little children will find the piece imposing and adults can look down on it.
And some of us can look right in it straight.
Yeah.
So let's talk about the transition. We're getting that Michael Strauss piece that you
showed.
It's
great.
With Dope Christmas and, that development, because that was the first piece when you had the chamber when you were already back here. And I realize we'll have to do another session with you, but let's just get this in for right now, is that you had that additional third chamber in Venice, and that all of a sudden gave you the ability to make some larger pieces, and that's where the untitled wall piece came out.
Well, the chamber that was here was right in this room, it was the one I had it built for me, and it arrived in 1969, and I started playing around with learning how to use it, and I started working on narrow strips of glass, trying to get the control over the evaporations across a 10-foot long piece of glass that was only 2 inches wide. And then I went to 4 inches wide, then I went to 8 inches wide, and then I went to 3 foot wide, and so on. The strips ended up being used for some shows that some of them were pretty interesting, but all of the work that I did really was experimental. I was trying to do something I hadn't seen before and make something in a manner that wasn't made before and so on, yeah.
Can you describe, to me, I can't figure out what's going on. Parts of it are mirrored, parts of it are coated black, which
Well, they're two pieces, two kinds of glass, white glass and black glass strips. They're 10 foot long and 6 inches wide. And in this thing we're looking at, there's a space of 6 inches between a black piece and a white piece and a black piece and a white piece and so on. And the coatings all are, each piece of glass is reflective where it touches the floor. And then depending on how the gradient is on each of the pieces determines how it reflects light from over here. The white piece is pretty much white glass disappears into the white paint of the wall, and the black ones obviously don't do that. They absorb light, and where they're coated, they reflect light.
But it's a fascinating play when we saw it, because you said the white disappears on top and reflects on the bottom.
Yeah.
And the black reflects two different ways.
Well, it depends on if you mix it up. You could improvise with the piece. This piece can be done in the put together with the reflection of the black or the white being at the top, and it, you know, you could mix it up. These things were made for improvisation. All of my sculptures were made to improvise with.
And then, but one of the cool things, at least when we saw it, and we only saw part of it, is that rather than looking like a reflection of the room, it looks like you're seeing behind it into another room.
Uh-huh. Well, I I guess that's what it was supposed to do. It was just to weave the reflected light into the wall, and the light of the floor, you know, it was all part of the thing. The wall itself became part of the sculptures, and it was an interesting piece. It was there were more panels than what to the original piece. I think this piece is made of what survived, because I remember Christmas contacting me many years ago about replacing some of the panels, and then I didn't do it, so.
Well, even when you were making the piece, wasn't there several panels that the effect of the coating wasn't really working? I mean, what was that?
No, the coatings worked on all of them, but the coatings were not the same on all of them. Yeah, the coatings all work on those pieces.
So when you said the coatings weren't the same, does that mean you're using different metals? Or
no, it meant that the gradients varied. Some of the coatings traveled further across the 10-foot length, and some of it stayed more in closer to one edge of the thing. And I didn't have a formula. I just made the stuff and stuck it up on the wall. And that was the piece. It was very spontaneous. I just decided, let's try this, and got the glass and coated it and stuck it on the wall, and that was the piece, and it looked okay. I didn't have to do anything else. I like it when the work goes simple like that. You make a decision and you look at the evidence it either works or it doesn't work. Or maybe it doesn't work in that light, the effort is honest, it's just what it is, you know. It's nothing more than what you see right there.
As Andrew said too.
If you hang this in the gallery, I don't want you to put anything that reflects in it across from it. I want the ambient light from the wall across to be the light source for this piece. You don't put any light on the piece. You put it on the wall, on a white wall that the piece faces.
What Andrew was saying before, I mean, there's really an incredible effect as a viewer that you get when you're looking at it, because it's this sense of almost, you know, infinity, because you can't tell where the wall, you know, part of the wall is reflecting back at you and part of it looks like it's going in simultaneously.
Yeah. Well, gradients do strange things to your eye, and that's why I like them so much.
But were you saying there was an element of chance in how the gradient, or were you very precise?
Oh yeah, there's always a chance. It's all chance. I mean, everything is chance. When I work on the cubes, is my only opportunity to improvise is after I've made the parts and how they orient to each other. How the gradient on one panel relates to the gradient over here. I can turn it any one of four ways, but that's a lot of options. If you think there's six parts times four sides times all the different other permutations that could, where it could go and so on, it's almost infinite. It's the factor of 24.
One last question is that we're making a bold move, Larry, because the 40-inch cube is going into the painting gallery.
Uh-huh.
And it's going to be surrounded by Diebenkorn, Sam Francis, Ed Boucher,
Lee Mulliken,
David Hockney and Ron Davis.
Good people. Oh, sorry.
How do you feel, I mean, Andrew, maybe you can talk a little bit about what the impact is, but how do you feel about the idea of having the cube in the middle of the gallery?
Well, how do you feel about it? It's your show.
I'm asking you, how do you feel?
You want my personal or professional opinion?
Both, one at a time.
One is worthless. I'll only give you one. The other's priceless.
Give us your personal opinion.
Tell us how you really feel.
Well, before I do that, can I ask you a couple of questions? Why would you consider doing that in the first place? Is it a practical reason that you don't have room to isolate it with or put it in to thing a room with simpler images? Why are you considering doing this? You must have a reason if it's not practical.
It's the idea of looking at something and things that demand a certain amount of attention, and that we feel like that the cube, the 40-inch cube, deserves as much as attention as a painting, and to be able to put into that environment and hold it up with the great masters.
Listen, that piece is as tough as anything that any of those guys did, and it's as honest an example as anything those guys did, and maybe more honest than some of it, probably has as much skill as they did when they did theirs too. So I got no problem with it on that level, you know, but I as long as the piece has a chance to breathe and to be seen, that's all. Is it a big giant room that where it'll squat in the center and okay,
no other object in the room?
Yeah. That sounds fine with me. I don't mind that.
Well, to us, it was the only object that we thought could go in that room with all of these kind of perfect paintings that needed to be a sculptural object, as you were sort of suggesting, of the same.
Yeah, I don't have any problem with that. I'm just to be included, I feel honored. But I have no axes to grind against any of that kind of stuff. Usually those pieces are, like when Zwirner had it, he had it with minimal kinds of stuff all around him, you know. And that, it held its own with that stuff, and although I didn't see the show, I saw pictures of it, and I have no problems with how you use it. Just handle it carefully. There's not very many of them. I actually did one or two that were 44 inches. They were impossible to move. Impossible.
I didn't think that you would have a problem with it. I thought that you'd be somewhat flattered. You might have another response.
No, I think it's fine. I'm honored. Those are auspicious artists that you mentioned. It's an honor to be included with them. And will this be in that same space? Can you give it to the white wall across from it? With nothing on it?
Well, the wall is 40-something feet away. It'll just have a Mary Course on it, so you won't see the Mary Course, which is white anyway.
Uh-huh. Well, that sounds cool. Yeah. Then you might want to put some light on the floor in front of it. Is it a light-colored floor?
It's a wood floor.
Is it light wood?
It's light wood. Should we put some light on it?
Uh-huh. Yeah, you should put a little light on the floor in front of it. Not just a wash of light so that because the angle of people's view will be looking down sort of at the reflective parts if you hang it like that. And so their vision will see the light floor, and that's what will give you that sliced kind of feeling to it.
We can definitely do that. Hmm. There's nothing around it. But
yeah.
And I think we discussed, too, that we work with you to pick the right color for the wall. You know, okay. Make sure it's the right white.
Well, you can do it yourself by just going by the white of the white glass, the whitest white that the glass is, that's the color we want the wall.
Yeah. We're building a special wall for it, so that, because our walls have ventilation on the bottom, and it has to go down all the way.
Uh-huh. So it'll stand off the wall slightly? Or will the wall just be, the whole wall be furred out?
No, it'll be a freestanding wall that doesn't go to the edges.
Is there space behind it?
20 feet.
20 feet behind it. Does it go to the ceiling, the wall?
No.
So it's a partition that stands how high?
We can make it as high as we... Our ceiling is 27 feet. I think we're thinking the wall would go...